Hi everyone, welcome to today's live stream here at Lee Valley. We're going to be making a giant block tower for some outdoor play. So let's get started. We'll see where everyone's signing in from just before we start building this. And yeah, so we'll just see what's up. It's a beautiful Friday here in Ottawa and we're looking forward to the long weekend. So I hope everyone has a nice weekend as well ahead. Let's just see here. So one thing, I'll get started as well, just saying that I'm building this with 2x4 spruce that I picked up at a local big box store. It's easy to use. One thing you do want to make sure is you want to make sure that you start off with fairly straight wood. But apart from that, it's easy, super easy to make, and it's a lot of fun to play with outside, and hours and hours of fun. So maybe what I'll do is I'll also start with some of the dimensions here, and we'll mention these as well. Hello, Leanne from Ottawa. Nice to see you're watching here. So the dimensions on each block are 9 inches long by 3 inches wide, and they're also 1 3/8 inches in depth, or in thickness, you should say. So I started off with purchasing six 2x4s at roughly just under 8 feet. And I was able to cut down. So the whole game, you need to have 54 pieces in total. So what I did was I cut most of them at the shop just to kind of help with getting things going and everything else. And yeah, so then what I'll do is I've got a couple here that I'm gonna cut. I'm gonna talk about how I finish the edges so that they're easy to hold, so there's no scraping or anything like that. And about sanding and finishing as well. Hello, Teresa from Cowichan Valley. How are things on Vancouver Island? So far, we've got a couple of people here in Canada, so that's fantastic. Yeah, so anyways, like I said, big thing, you need to have 54 pieces. Once you're all said and done, I think you'd be generally around 5 feet tall once you start actually playing with these. So it's a lot of fun. One thing you want to do is you want to lay down a substrate, a piece of plywood or something on the ground just to give yourself a nice steady, sturdy base, and then you can build from there. That's right, Teresa. We've seen that it has been very hot. It's a lot cooler here. Hello, Doug from Georgia. That's pretty amazing. So I'll start over a little bit here again. So with this giant block game, you need to have 54 pieces. So I started off with 6 2x4s. I cut these guys down to 9 inches in length, 1 3/8 inches in depth, and 3 inches wide. You want to make sure that whatever dimensions you start with, that you do have a nice square, so that when you're putting them together, you know, you're able to, you know, pop them out and it's easy to put them back and you're not worried about kind of the configuration of everything. Yeah, so most of these I did cut at our wood shop. I used a table saw, so I have a cross-cut sled. I set up a block on my right, trimmed it on my left, slid it to the block, cut it, and I just did a repeatable cut for all of these. You can also use a chop saw if that's easier for you. I would have used the chop saw probably, but one of the guys at the shop was using it, so I thought, hey, we'll do this on the table saw. You can also cut them by hand. I've got a couple different saws here, a couple Japanese saws that we can use. So you've got a Ryoba that's available here at Lee Valley as well. And we have a Dozuki that I'll be using to cut a couple of these down. So what I'll do is I'll start by marking 9 inches. I'm just gonna throw down a second clamp here on the side, just so I can hold that in place. I'm gonna use a combination square to give myself a nice straight edge here. And the reason why I have my board supported underneath with these little pieces is just so that it's the board's not going to pop, move around or anything like that, and it's just going to cut and I've got it, it'll hold it in place. So I'm going to use the Dozuki and just cut just on the line there. So bear with me for a second while I go through and cut this down. So I've made my cut. Now what I want to actually do is sand them. So I guess in theory you wouldn't really need to necessarily sand and finish these. Here in Ottawa, our summers are very humid. I'd be concerned that the wood would actually stick together on a hot summer day. So what I would be doing and what we'll be doing with these guys is lightly sanding them, and then we'll actually be using an exterior grade Varathane to allow them to be sealed and everything else. So if you leave it outside in the weather, the dew, anything like that, you're going to be totally fine and the wood will be okay. So because these were originally 2x4s, so what I did was I'll go through the way that I did it. I was less concerned with how twisted or cupped the boards were. I ended up jointing the face, one edge. Then what I did was I ran them through the planer just to get them to a universal or a uniform thickness, I should say. With buying the 2x4s at a big box store, if you take your time and find a couple good long straight pieces, then you're able to actually just chop them down. You don't need to joint them. You run them through the planer if you want. What I did was, the reason why I planed them and everything else was that there was quite a bit of wane, and I just wanted to be able to remove some of that, remove the logos and everything else from the sawmill. And so I've got my pieces. Like I said, you do have to have 54 in total for the game. So I've made a sanding block here. So I just had an old scrap of wood, grabbed a piece of sandpaper, and I'm just going to hold it like that. You just want to break the edges. So you'd want to go through and do all four edges on the long side. You can use an orbital if you have it. I didn't bring an orbital in just because of the sound. I didn't want it to be too crazy for everyone. What I would do is I'd break the edges on the ends as well. You just don't want to have any slivers anywhere. Do the other side. So if you, like I was saying, if you did happen to have a chop saw, you can cut them on a chop saw. Hello, Eddie. I hope you're having a great day. If you have a chop saw, you can do it on that. You can do it with a table saw, as long as you're cutting safely with a cross-cut sled. That's totally fine. That's the way that I cut these. I just find it tends to be a little bit easier. And like I was saying too before, the chop saw was being used at the time. So what I would do is go through all of these boards, all 54 pieces. I actually think I'll have to cut one more to get to 54, so I'll do that in a second here. And I'll use the other Japanese saw I brought in. Like I was saying, you could use this, or you could do the sanding with an orbital if you wanted to. You just want to make sure that with an orbital, one, you don't catch your fingers or anything like that. But depending on the pad, whether it's a hard pad or the soft pads, you might actually round it over too much, or if that's what you want to do, that's totally fine as well. I just wanted to break the edges just to give it a little bit of a cleaner look. You could also use a block plane. So I have a Veritas plane here. So what I've done is I've just adjusted it ever so slightly just to break the edge like that. So this will give it a nice clean finish too. And breaking the edges will actually make it easier for you to remove pieces and everything else while you're playing. So what you could do is, if you have a hand plane, you can just lop down the edges like that. The great thing about these guys, you can cut across the grain as well. So block plane works really, really, really well to clean those up. So there's another one. So like I was saying, some of these here, you can actually see a little bit of machine marks. So if you wanted to go through and sand all of these with an orbital, you can definitely do that. You might just want to hit them with a 120, 150, 180, or maybe just 120, 180. And that'll give you a nice smooth finish to accept the, or sorry, a nice smooth finish of wood to accept the finish as well. And once again, I didn't bring in an orbital only because of the sound that it would be making while we're here. But you do want to make sure that your edges are nice and smooth, and you can sand the end grain. Do we happen to have any questions or anything so far? So I started off with six 2x4s from one of the big box stores. I broke it down to 9 inches in length, 1 3/8 inches wide, and then, or sorry, 3 inches wide, and then 1 3 inches in thickness. And they're square, so with those dimensions, when you put them together and you overlap them like that, you'll have a you'll have your tower, and you'll be able to build up from there. So that back down there, there. So like I was saying, I wanted to make sure that the edges were nice and broken. This is a very simple project. Anybody who with a couple basic tools can do it, and it's so much fun. So one thing, like I was saying, is that you definitely want to have a piece of plywood or a box or anything like that on the ground that will actually give you a flat surface to start building with, because if not, it could be a little tippy or anything like that. So you want to make sure that you keep it as sturdy as possible. So I'm going to use another Japanese saw here to cut the last board. So I'll measure out, I'm going to move this clamp over a little bit, put this guy back here so it doesn't move on me. So 9 inches. I'm going to use a combination square just to give myself a straight edge to cut with. So if you happen to have a miter box, you could also use a miter box, or like I was saying, a chop saw or a table saw, which is what I used just safely with a crosscut sled. I'm going to just adjust this 1 second. Move that over just a little bit. That one there. I'm just clamping both sides down so that when I finish my cut, that doesn't pop back. So what I'll do is, once again, I'll just kind of break down the edges, just soften up the end grain there. And the reason why I was saying that you just want to break the edges is just so it makes it easier to go together as a as the tower. And when you're removing pieces and placing other pieces, if there's any kind of rough edges, it's liable to catch on the layer below or above. So we just want to stay away from that and make it as easy as possible to put these together. So like I was saying before, I started off with six 2x4s picked up at a local big box store. I broke them down to 9 inches in length, 3 inches in width, and 1 3/8 inch in thickness. I ran them through the planers to get them down to the final thickness. The boards were quite cupped and twisted in places and in a lot of wane, which is just kind of the live edge on the edge of the board. So I just wanted to give them a nice finished dimension. They're all the same, and yeah, so they're easy to use, and it's ready to go. So this piece here, use that. So this guy here, I've broken down. So for finish, like I was saying, you don't necessarily have to finish these. The reason why I decided that we would finish them is that here in Ottawa, the weather, the summers are quite humid, and I'd be worried that if we were using these outside, what would happen is they would end up sticking together. So the finish, once the finish is on and everything's dry, they should slide together nicely, play well together. And yeah, so you just want to make sure that you're using an outdoor finish. So I'm just using an outdoor Varathane that has been stirred. Just want to make sure you always stir your finish. Just going to put this aside for a second. So the great thing about a water-based finish is that it dries really, really quickly. You'd only need to do probably one coat on the whole thing. You wouldn't need to do anything more than that. Now, the other really nice thing that I like using water-based finishes is that it doesn't change or really amber the look of the wood. I prefer to try to keep it as natural as possible. So a lot of the furniture that I build, I always try to use natural finishes that aren't going to really dramatically change the look of everything. So you do want to make sure you get the end grain really, really well, because that's what's going to soak up most of the moisture and everything, or the end grain will pull the moisture in from the air. And then what you could do also after this is just give it a light sand. Just hit them by hand really, really quickly, maybe with a 220 or even a 320 grit. And after that, you're fine. There'd be no issues with having it outside like that. And with being sealed with sealed with an outdoor grade finish will just allow you to actually leave them outside in case you do happen to leave them in your yard or anything like that after a really crazy game of giant block towers. You could leave those and you wouldn't have any issues. So let that sit for a minute and then I'll do the other side. So I can do one of these guys here too. Actually, I'll do this guy. And then the water-based finish is great. Like I was saying, it dries really, really quickly. So I would be able to play with these by the time I get home if I was to finish all of them as well. You could go really, really fancy if you wanted and get some really nice hardwood if you wanted. These are just spruce 2x4s. It's very inexpensive. I think the wood was a total of roughly $23 or $24. So it's an inexpensive project, but it'll be a lot of fun. Kids love the game, adults love the game, and anyone can build it. For machine-wise, you can cut them on a table saw, as long as you're using a cross-cut sled and cutting safely across the grain. You could use a chop saw, you could use a miter gauge if you have one, and you can also cut them by hand with Japanese saws or traditional hand saws, whatever's easiest. So most likely a lot of people will have these tools at home. If not, you can always find them here at Lee Valley. We do carry all the stuff that I would have needed as well. Yeah, so you can see how the grain or the finish isn't changing the look of the wood. It's a satin finish, so it's going to dry really, really nice. And like I was saying, the reason why I'm finishing these boards is just so that they're easier when you're stacking and unstacking them. If you weren't going to finish them, with our humidity here in Ottawa, they might actually stick together. You could possibly use a wax as well, just like a paste wax, furniture wax. Just do that. What part did you use? So when I'm sanding by hand here, I'm just using 100 or 120 grit, and all I was doing was breaking down the corners. You could sand them to a much higher grit if you did want to remove any kind of machine marks or anything like that. I just didn't want to bring in an orbital, which would be too loud and too noisy and bothersome for you guys. So I just broke down the edges by hand, a little bit on the end grain, just to remove kind of any of the broken fibers from cutting. But if you did that, once the finish is dry, I would just kind of lightly wipe them and just remove any of the air bubbles or anything that you can see, the dust that might be drying, or even like a little broken fiber there. And then when those are stacked, like I said, they'll be easier to stack and unstack as you're playing. Like I was saying, you definitely do want to break the edges, whether you're using sandpaper, a block plane, or anything like that, just to give it a bit of a softer feel. As you're pulling them out like that, you might actually find that if it did have a really, really sharp edge, they might not, or they might catch, and some of the fibers might catch on the level, either layer above or below. And if that happens, then it's going to tumble. Nobody wants to be the one who makes it tumble. It's a lot of fun, though. It's quite a simple project. Like I said, I just started off with 6 2x4s, broke them down to 9 inches, and then I planed them down, or I cut them on the table saw to 9 inches in length, 3 inches wide, 1 3/8 in thickness. And that gives me a nice 9x9 square base like that to start with. You can go a little bit longer if you wanted. I just thought that these were nice, and they were kind of on the smaller side, so they're easy to transport. They're not going to take up a whole bunch of spot or a whole bunch of space in the back of your car if you're taking them anywhere like that, or even in your garage. So it's getting there. Yeah, so like I was saying too, if you wanted to use a block plane, you could use that as well, just to kind of clean up the edge a little bit. And you get these nice little curly pieces as well. You definitely don't have to use 2x4s if you didn't want to. You could do, if you wanted to make these, a nice bespoke giant block tower game, you could use maple, you could use ash. If you're gonna use something outside, you could always use cedar. Ash would be fantastic, white oak would be great. If you happen to have a ton of mahogany or anything like that, you could use that as well. But these just happen to be a great cost. It's very cost effective. Like I was saying, I think the 6 2x4s were roughly about $24, $25. So it's not going to be an expensive game to build or an expensive project, and there's nothing here that's overly costly or cumbersome to do it. So so anyways, like I said, you do want to finish it. I'm just using an outdoor grade Varathane. It's fantastic. Brush it on, leave it for, usually it's just a few minutes, 20 minutes sort of thing, and then just give it a light little kind of wipe. Just to remove any of the bubbles or anything else like that, and then after that you're ready to go. You do want to make sure that you have 54 pieces in total. So that's what the traditional game has, 54 pieces. When you're playing it outdoors, you do want to start off on whether you're on a picnic table or the ground, something that one allows you to get the bottom pieces out, piece of plywood, something like that, just to make sure that you're sitting nice and flat. And then stack it up and have fun. So like I was saying, six 2x4s allowed me to get the 54 pieces at these dimensions here. And so we do have, and one thing that's fantastic is that I'm using the new search and rescue apron that's available here at Lee Valley. It has fantastic pockets, super comfortable, and it looks, I love the look of these. And it's actually, I use an apron in the shop all the time. I use one of these guys, and it's, you know, stops me from coming home with stained clothes, which is fantastic. And so anyways, everything else here is available at Lee Valley as well. The saws that I was using, the block plane. It's, so like I was saying, it's a project that anyone can build. It doesn't take a whole lot of skill set or time to actually do so. you could make it in pretty much just a matter of a couple hours. And yeah, so anyways, I wanted to thank everyone for tuning in today. It's been fun. If you do happen to have any questions with regards to the game or anything like that, you can always reach out to us. If you happen to want to follow along, this is the second of three outdoor games live streams that we're going to be doing. We've got the next one coming up in August. And yes, if you happen to have any questions, you can always reach out to socials@leevalley.com. And I hope everyone has a fantastic and wonderful long weekend here in Canada. Thank you, everyone.